graduates. Today, it's not a New Year's Eve party. It looks like it could be. 2022, but now that's for the graduates of 2022. Not that, you know, not thankful for a new year. We're about halfway into it though, so it could get better. It could get better. So glad you're all here today in God's house to worship. Anyone have any announcements this morning? Any announcements? All right, go for it.
Next Saturday is the auction just down the street, 603 East Centennial. Matthew, do you have helpers yet?
I don't know, do I?
Nobody's called you, nobody's called me. Matt needs at least two other guys to help him out. The ladies' luncheon is at the same time. And I don't want to miss that. So as soon as it's over, I'll go down and take over for Matt. But please, guys, somebody tell Matt you'll help him. Thanks.
All right. Any other announcements? Yes, ma'am.
Vacation Bible School is June 1st through 3rd. We really need the children to be registered. It is for kids age 3 through middle school. So there's a link. A Google link that you can sign up on, or there's papers out there. So grandkids, whatever, June 1st through 3rd, but we need to sign up by the 22nd to make sure we can make all the shirts. And we're going to have a VBS meeting this Wednesday evening at 6. 6. This Wednesday.
All right.
Marcia said, mentioned the DWF brunch. Next Saturday, 10:30, we'll be selling tickets. After the service is over, if you would like to come or meet women and with their daughters or nieces or friends or any females are welcome to come to the brunch at 10:30. Also,
just, you know, with a diploma. General ed. Okay. I got with the business thing. So, yeah, very, very proud of them. We have any prayer concerns or joys or anything like that? Jay Chansey's visitation and funeral service will be here on Thursday, May 19th. The visitation is from 1 to 2, and the service will begin at 2. So, hope you're able to.
That reminds me, that's also lunch bunch day, and so far we are still planning to do lunch bunch, but if I hear from that group that they want to come to the funeral, we'll delay.
All right. Okay, any other concerns, joys?
Thank you.
pray with me. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this opportunity to come before you today, worship you, sing praises to you, and give you thanks for our many, many blessings. And this is a special day where we honor our graduates, great academic accomplishments of our young people. We ask your blessing upon them, upon Tyler, Caleb, and Chelsea, and Skylar, and Kaya. We ask that you continue to be with them and guide them. Help them to know your will, to serve you, and to make this world a better place because they are disciples of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Help them to be a light to all people. Help us, all the rest of us too, who are either done with our formal education or maybe we're still in school. Maybe we'll go back to school someday. Who knows? But we all need you, Lord. We need your Spirit to be with us, to fill us, to guide us, to give us patience and strength, keep us from worry and doubt. Help us to find peace in you and you alone, Lord. For you are our rock and our salvation. Lord, today we ask your blessing on the family of Jacob Chancy. We ask that you bless all of them, get them here safely for her service. We ask your blessing upon her service on Thursday. We ask your blessing upon our booth at the auction next Saturday. Help us to find some volunteers who don't plan to attend the ladies' brunch. Ask your blessing upon the brunch as well. We ask all this in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory of God. Amen. The scripture comes from Matthew chapter 6, verses 24 to 34. Word of no one can serve two masters. For a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body or what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to this span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today, and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, what will we drink, what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things. And indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today. The word of the Lord. Now, if I could go back in time and tell my younger self anything, say, go back to when I was like 10, I would tell him, on August 14th, 2002, and that's a week and a half after you will marry Julie Woolhite, wait, you better get a pen and paper and write this down, because I know you'll forget. Okay, here it is. On August 14th, 2002, the winning Powerball numbers are... I'm just kidding. That's not all I would tell him. But I would definitely tell him, stop worrying, because it won't ever do you any good ever. Almost all the things you worry about will never happen. And the very few that do won't turn out nearly as bad as you're afraid they will. It'll all work out. That would be about it. And I deliver this message to my much younger self, because if I got back all the time I spent worrying in my much younger days, I would get back most of my much younger days. Worrying has been one of the biggest wastes of time, or probably the biggest waste of time and energy in my life. It's robbed me of so much joy on too many occasions. And I'm thankful that our Lord Jesus has told us not to worry. It doesn't do any good. That's magnificent advice. And I want to take a second here to define worry, make sure we're all on the same page. It's a state of anxiety and uncertainty over actual or potential problems. And so potential problems are really the most annoying. You ever heard of Bill Rogers? He's a heck of a guy. I came across a quote of his the other day. It reminded me of him, and I thought he must have said something insightful about worry, because he said something insightful about everything else. So I found this quote. He said, worrying is like paying on a debt that may never come due. That's exactly right. In my experience, it just about never comes due. So true. And it's that paying on that debt that's the real booger, the mulling over and over things that you really can't do anything about. You really can't. Now, there are genuine concerns in life. Read the news right now. There are genuine concerns, right? But with God's help and the help of others, friends, our loved ones, brothers and sisters in Christ, we can take real, concrete actions to deal with real problems right here and now. Do what we can. And sure, some planning might be necessary. Might need to think it through a little bit, but we've got to be careful, because planning can become worry in disguise. And you got to remember this. Remember, there's a time to plan, and it's not all the time. That's all. Worry left unchecked can go on and on and on, because our brains have tricked themselves into believing that worry serves a real purpose. It actually accomplishes something just besides making us miserable or distracted or annoyed or all of the above. And it never ends. Worrying just leads to more worrying. And it's kind of like a way of life. If we believe worrying is worthwhile, that it truly serves a purpose, it just keeps going and going and going. I read a good illustration of the futility of worry several years ago. Man's on a journey, walking down a path, and encounters a wild dog. And the dog is not friendly at first. He bares his teeth, growls at him, barks at him. But the man is able to calm him down, even able to pet the dog, and the dog is calm and docile, actually is friendly. Well, then, as soon as that happened, another dog shows up. And the dog's angry, growling, baring his teeth. The man's able to doesn't appreciate it. He's waist deep in dogs, trying to calm each one down. You know, it's impossible. You can't do it. There's no way to live. And that's how worrying works. Even if we can worry something into submission to make peace with it, eventually another worry will take its place. And sometimes things we thought we worried to death will become resurrected, even more powerful than before. Now, we just heard Jesus ask his disciples, can any of you by worrying add a single hour to your span of life? Well, of course, the answer is no. You can't. Not at all. And, but we do it anyways. But it doesn't do us any good. You know, many people think worry is a normal part of life, especially if you're a parent. But it's bad for us. It's actually hazardous to our health. It's toxic. It really is. It can actually shorten our lifespan. Worry can negatively affect our hearts, our lungs, our stomach, intestines, our body weight. It can also cause a spike in blood sugar, which is especially bad for diabetics. Worry won't ever do us any good, but there's a very good chance it'll do something bad to us if we keep it up long enough. So we really ought to work on cutting it out. Have you heard of the serenity prayer? You ever heard that? God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. Wise words. Well, it was on a poster in the bathroom in my office at the First Christian Church of Independence, Missouri, when I served there. It was pretty cool. I was like, had my desk right here and a little bathroom right next to it. Worked out great because I drank a lot of coffee back then. And one day, the senior minister told me that she had used my bathroom one day, because it was a lot closer than the one she had to go all the way down the hall to the restaurant. And she told me she used it, and wanted to know that was all right. I said, oh, of course, it was fine, any time. I mean, well, it'd be a little weird. It was while I was sitting at my desk, but, you know, any other time. And she said while she was in there, she noticed the poster with the serenity prayer on it, and she wondered if the reason it was there, because I suffered from some kind of bowel distress, and I put up the poster to comfort me in my moments of greatest discomfort. But I should have known, I'm all right, just fine. But I did find out, not too long after that, that the previous occupant of that office had put up the poster, and I asked her, why did you put up the poster? And she said it was because to help her deal with a particularly aggravated church member. So she was dealing with a different kind of pain, you know, but serenity prayer can be very, very helpful in many different circumstances, especially when we want to break the cycle of worry. We can ask God to grant us the serenity to accept the things we cannot change, to the courage to change the things we can, and for the wisdom to know the difference. Now, for some, worrying can't just be shut off by flipping a switch. It's not really a choice. Some people's brains are hardwired to worry because of their brain chemistry or because of an extreme traumatic experience or a prolonged psychological trauma. Fortunately, though, there are effective medical treatments for this. And I encourage everyone who finds their worrying uncontrolled to pray first and seek treatment. So now that I've made the strongest case ever for why not to worry, I want to turn now specifically to our graduates and everybody else. Besides never worrying for the rest of your life, never again, I want to encourage you to remember how young you are. It's very important. I'm serious. Keep that in mind until you're in your, you know, mid-80s. And I tell you this because when I was like 18, 19, 21, I felt really old. I felt more in my early 20s than I did in my late 20s. It's really strange. I felt like I burned all my bridges and I'd sank all my ships. And all that was left was to try to find something pure in all the darkness and decay in this world. Now, it's probably because I was listening to a lot of Bruce Springsteen and George Jones at the time, which don't ever do together. It's horrible. But I remember graduates, odds are you've got a lot of time ahead of you. Time is on your side. And you've got more options for how to spend that time than you know. So many options, more glorious options to succeed and fail than you can imagine. And you will do both in ways you haven't imagined. Enjoy it all. Cherish it. I still do. I'm still doing it. Even in my advanced age, I'm looking forward to a brighter future. Yeah. You know, in just over a year, I'm going to get a colonoscopy. Yeah. I'm going to get the shingle vaccine. Oh, heck yeah. I'm going to get my discount down at the Mickey D's. Can I get an amen? Wait. Hello? Future? Is that you? Yeah, you belong to me now. You're welcome. That's the kind of attitude you've got to have, class of 2022. And I tell you, above all, if you ever want to feel like a winner, even though it seems like you're a one-legged man and life is a butt-kicking contest, always put your relationship with God first. Seek His kingdom first. Seek to do His will first. That means seek His kingdom first, and that means strive to do His will first. Keep WWJD on the tip of your mind all the time. What Jesus would do is the thing to do. Do that and you'll always get what you need. Don't worry about it. Listen to Nike and just do it. And I know it's not always that easy. But you know what Jesus did do a lot? He prayed. He prayed a lot. Jesus, the Son of God, prayed. He was closer to God the Father than anyone ever, and He prayed. So that means we definitely need to pray a lot. If we want the closest possible relationship with Almighty God, we've got to pray. If we want to do God's will, we've got to pray. If we want to be free from worry and set free to see a glorious future filled with God's blessings, we've got to pray. Amen. And if you would like to become a member of this congregation, we ask that you come forward after our invitation hymn.
Thank you.
As often as we eat this bread and drink the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for all that we have learned from you, all that your Spirit has shown us, all that we have learned from our brothers and sisters in Christ, all of our Sunday school teachers and ministers and parents and everyone who's helped us to learn more about you. We pray, Lord, that your Spirit be with us now. Bless the bread and the cup of each and every one of us. Fill us. Help us to experience communion with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as if for the very first time. Make it new and fresh, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Come to the table. Every day, all day.